Like so much of being a Christian is taking your identity first as a child of God. Like you said, I think a little earlier, right? Rich, was it you? I don't remember. But we take our identity as children of God before anything else. So the fact that we're made in God's image is we're image bearers of Christ as we walk around through the culture and we go about our business. And Paul was doing it as a tent maker. I do it on Wall Street. You do it wherever you go. And you're going to interact with people and you're going to say things differently than I would say them. And that's awesome. God loves that. And yes, there are times that people are not representing God properly, but we can only do what we can do. We can handle our half of that equation, right? So I talked about expressing the essence of God's true nature from inside of us. That Psalm 2 talks about the heathen rage. And we have to remember Ephesians 6 says we wrestle not against flesh and blood. So if you're talking to somebody that's pro-choice and you're pro-life, that can get very antagonistic very quickly. Anybody can argue. The harder way to live is doing it in a way that you can interact with people and do what Jesus did with those Pharisees over and over and over again. When he met a sinner, he didn't just shame them. He interacted with them. He got a relationship going, and then he gave them the truth in a way that they could understand it. Why? Because he prayed. He lived in the hiding place of God's glory. And he's the King of Kings, right? It's the honor of kings to search out the matter. God hides it in the secret place, and then we go search it out. And I think, why does he do that? Not because he's mean, but because he knows that people are very vulnerable to the advice that we give. You could go back to Elisha. Remember, the mentee, Elijah was the mentor, and he had the young prophet that asked for the double mantle, right? I want a double portion. And the younger one was being confronted by Ahab and Jezebel's son, who was the king of the northern kingdom. And Jehoshaphat was on Elisha's side. So they came together. I won't go into the whole story, but it's so telling how alert Elisha was in the spirit, because he knew he had to give a prophetic word. But Ahab and Jezebel's son just triggered him like, oh man, why are you coming to me? Why don't you go to the prophets of your father? Like, that's not the best attitude for a prophet to have if you're about to give a word, because you'll speak through your flesh. So he had enough sense, spiritual maturity, to understand. Before he gave the word, he said, bring me a minstrel. You get it? I've got to get in the hiding place of God's glory before I release this word. Because in my condition right now, if I release it, it's going to be God. It's going to be my soul. It's going to be the flesh talking. This is every word that we speak should be filtered through God. Oh. Anybody want to leave right now? Sound like too much work? No, it's a privilege that we have that he gives us. It says in Hebrews 11 that every one of the people that were listed in the hall of faith, none of them saw the promise fulfilled, and yet they lived it out because they had a dream of going to a better place, a better resurrection. Another day's teaching, but look, we do have the Spirit in us. But if we don't access him, if we're not asking the Holy Spirit for advice, that's on us. You got a warehouse full of food and people are starving because you're not giving them access to it. I hope that doesn't sound condemning. I'm trying to encourage you to pray more and to open up your understanding of what prayer really is. It's a dialogue with God all day long, 24/7, higher than 5G bandwidth. I already said this part here. I think I can go to the next verse, which is in 2 Corinthians chapter 2. And it says, God always makes his grace visible in Christ, who includes us as partners of his endless triumph. That's a passion, all right? Let's just think about what he's saying here. Doesn't matter what my background is, right? The thief on the cross, Jesus said, today you'll be with me in paradise. You don't have to hand in a resume to be a Christian. They don't say, well, we'll get back to you and let you know. Faith, it's just on faith. It has nothing to do with your track record, how bad you are. Doesn't matter. The Jews had a really hard time with this about Christianity. And here he's saying, regardless of your background, God will make his grace visible in Christ. And then Christ includes us as his partners of this endless triumph. Through what, though? It says yielded. Can you just look at somebody and say, you got to yield. Not easy to yield. I want to hold on my right to be right. Yielding means pliable, teachable, soft, oil, Holy Spirit, oil, breath of God. Look, I have an eternal perspective. Even if I'm being falsely accused, I have to wait for the Lord to say, I want you to take this to the human resources department or whatever, because many times these are just tests of our metal, right? What we're made of. And the people that are working with us don't even realize they're working spiritual warfare against us because they're living off a different worldview. And their worldview is if you're talented in the office, you're a threat to them sometimes. Right? Well, how would Paul have thought about that? It's like, pray for them. Give them a prophetic word. Let them know that we're not adversaries. You don't have to feel threatened by anything. Let's just do this together. And that's the good thing about being out with other unsaved people on a regular basis if you're a minister. So you don't forget who God loves. It's easy as a pastor to spend all your time with Christians. But none of the leaders in the Bible did that. Paul even specifically says, even though I have the right to receive compensation, I'm choosing not to. Because I want you to understand it's not about money. It's about your soul. It's about God interacting with you and making you come alive. And then, I love this part. You don't need perfume if you're filled with the Holy Spirit because you give off an aroma. None of the ladies are saying amen right now. You can have both. It says, through our yielded lives, he spreads the fragrance of the knowledge of God everywhere we go. What a picture that is. Talk about convicting. Is he spreading God's fragrance through you on Facebook? Well, there's a fragrance, but is it God's fragrance? Look, man, I'm not trying to put anybody down, but emotions are running hot right now on Facebook, right? Things are being said there that you might end up regretting later. So always pray before you hit send because it stays up there forever, doesn't it? So I don't want to be that city with the walls broken down. I want to rule my spirit, but I can't in my own strength. So I'm constantly acknowledging to God. I recognize it's not by my might, my power, my willpower. It's by your spirit working through me. Help me be that yielded vessel, Lord. I want to give off the right fragrance. And then 15, he says, we become the unmistakable aroma of the victory of the anointed one to God, a perfume of life to those being saved. And it can be convicting. You know how the rest of that verse goes, probably that to those that are perishing, it doesn't smell so good because it means that they're going to have to change their life.